So after issue number 7 of the series left me disappointed, issue number 8 has come around and greatly renewed my interest. Although it's happening in a way that takes 2 steps forward and 1 step back. Green Lantern number 8 is written by Jeremy Adams, with art by Amanke Nalpan, colors by Romulo Fajardo Jr., and letters by Dave Sharp. The title of this issue is Hope No More. Razor is filling Hal in on what happened to the Blue Lantern homeworld of Odom. How one day the Blue Central Battery just erupted in a fiery explosion that engulfed most of the planet. At first, I thought this was supposed to be a case of the Orange Lantern power coming through the Blue Battery, just like how Sinestro's Yellow Ring was channeling Red Lantern energy, but I guess it's just an explosion. I'm also very curious about who was on Odom when all of this happened. Razor says that thousands died when the Blue Central Battery erupted, but nobody lives on Odom other than the Blue Lanterns, so does that mean there were thousands of Blue Lanterns on Odom? I thought St. Walker was still the only one. Was Razor a Blue Lantern at the time, or just some kind of acolyte in training? Does Razor have a ring of any color right now? Again, just like last issue, this story is stumbling when it tries calling back to the events of past Green Lantern runs, and I find it really distracting. But maybe that's just a me problem, so let's keep going. Pirates came to pillage what was left after the Blue Central Battery exploded and Razor stowed away on their ship. Their ultimate goal was to smuggle a shipment of weapons to Earth, which is how Razor made it to Hal. These pirates look similar to the people of the planet Lar that we saw back in issue 3 of this series, who have a business set up on Earth and have already supplied Sinestro with weapons and henchmen once, so it makes sense that they could be expecting an arms shipment. Razor indicates that what happened to the Blue Central Battery also happened to the Red and Yellow Central Batteries. Does that mean the flare-up we saw when Kilowog supposedly died was meant to be the Central Battery failing? I certainly didn't get that impression, but I guess maybe. Razor wants Hal's help in reaching the Guardians, or some other authority figure that can do something about the threat to the batteries that seems to be spreading across the universe. But Hal can't leave the planet right now, and every time he tries, his ring shuts down. Razor suggests that maybe the problem isn't with the ring, maybe it's psychological. Maybe deep down, part of Hal doesn't want to leave the planet. And I have to say, I like this idea. The ring is linked to the mind of the user, so it should pick up on any mental blocks you may have formed. Unfortunately, it's a good idea that goes nowhere, as Hal tries real hard to fly into space a few more times and keeps getting the exact same result. And speaking of trying the exact same thing over and over again, even though it always ends the same way, Carol shows up, because the last time she saw Hal, he was trying to stop Sinestro and a bunch of missiles. Hal never actually told her what happened or that he was okay. And now that they're face to face, he immediately starts laying it on thick again, asking her to take him back, that all she has to do is tell him to stay and he will. Remember that breakthrough Hal had when he talked to Barry a few issues ago? When he realized that the thing he needs to do is stop trying to win Carol back and just focus on being himself, and then maybe she'd fall for him all over again? This right here is the exact opposite of that. I can't help but feel sorry for Carol in all of this. It is totally unfair that she has to bear the burden of Hal's unreasonable expectations. The exchange they just had put all of the responsibility of the future of their relationship on her, which is really shitty because Hal blatantly didn't care about her decisions the first few times she turned him down and told him to leave. But now that he's inserted himself back into her life and stirred up old feelings, now he suddenly cares about what decision she'll make. You know, Chad and Mark interviewed Jeremy Adams on episode 545 of the Lantern Cast, and he said something interesting that I hadn't thought about before. To him, what makes Hal and Carol different from other DC couples is that they've known each other their entire lives. They can't even remember a time before they knew each other. And that puts Hal's actions in a clearer context, because ever since this series began, Hal has been acting as though it was a given that he and Carol could just pick up where they left off. And of course he'd think that, because she's always been there, so he thinks she always will be there. And when I look at panels like this, where Carol is sitting alone in her car, dealing with the thoughts and emotions flooding her mind, I hope to God that the lesson Hal learns is that No, she won't always be there. He took her for granted and he blew it. Hal Jordan needs to learn that the qualities that make him excel at being a Green Lantern do not cut it in other areas of life. And if he expects to live with other people, he has to change. Because when I look at this panel of Carol, I do not see someone who's one decision away from a happy relationship. Anyway, since Hal can't brute force his way into space, he takes Razor to go see Madame Xanadu, hoping that her magic can give them some insight into how they can leave the planet. Unfortunately, all she can tell them is that the sector has been thoroughly sealed off, both physically and mystically, and she can't do anything about it. She is able to tell Hal that if he goes back to the place where he fought Sinestro, the place where his ring's power suddenly surged, there will be answers waiting. They get interrupted when three Green Lanterns burst in, looking to arrest Razor on behalf of the United Planets, and look at this Rhino guy, he is so cool! Hal tries to explain to them what's going on so that all the Lanterns and the United Planets can tackle this problem together, and they immediately try to arrest both Razor and Hal. Hal fights back, and is going pretty well since these new Lanterns don't seem to be very well trained. Razor points out that they don't even have their personal shields raised on a strange planet they know nothing about. Both this book and the Jon Stewart book, Green Lantern War Journal, keep hitting home the idea that the Green Lanterns being recruited by the United Planets aren't receiving much training, and what little they do get seems to skip over a lot of basic concepts, which is good for Hal, since he can counter their numbers with his experience. Not to mention the occasional assist from Razor. Razor uses Rock Throw. It's super effective. The tide turns when two of the United Planets Lanterns suddenly shift to different powers in the emotional spectrum, using both fear and hope to fend off Hal and capture Razor. This is very interesting. It's also probably why the United Planets doesn't think they need better training. Being able to cycle through different aspects of the emotional spectrum whenever you want is an incredibly powerful tool, and to someone who lacks experience, power probably seems like the most important thing. Between this scene and the events of Green Lantern War Journal, it doesn't seem like every United Planets Lantern can access the emotional spectrum this way. None of the Lanterns in War Journal have done it, even when their lives were in danger. It may also be significant that the three Lanterns fighting Hal and Razor are wearing a style of uniform we haven't seen before, and they make a big deal about Hal's costume not being standard issue. It makes me wonder if what we're seeing is two different levels of Lantern, designated by their uniforms. Normal Green Lanterns and some sort of elite guard that can use more than one emotion in the spectrum. This also makes me think that the three Sinestro Corps members who tried to assassinate Tharos last issue were actually Green Lanterns sent by the United Planets, most likely Tharos himself, to sow chaos and manipulate Sinestro into joining them, while the United Planets is making moves behind the scenes to monopolize the emotional spectrum by blowing up all the central batteries. Remember, Oa has a power source that was formed by merging massive quantities of emotional spectrum energy. Maybe by manipulating it, the United Planets can send shockwaves out to the various central batteries, or maybe their agents are sabotaging the central batteries in some other way. No matter what, I'd be very surprised if Tharos and other like-minded politicians aren't directly responsible for what's been going on with the central batteries acting up all of a sudden. The Lanterns succeed in capturing Razor, and then leave the planet before Hal can follow. With no other recourse, he takes Madame Xanadu's advice and returns to the town in Spain where he fought Sinestro. Once again, Hal feels the power of his ring start to spike, only this time the ground opens up, revealing a hidden cave leading deep within the Earth. This is great. One way or another, we're about to find out what's been going on with Hal's ring. I know what I'm expecting to see down there, but we'll just have to wait and see what Jeremy Adams has in store for us next time. But before we go, there's also an 8-page Kyle Rayner backup story written by Ron Mars with art by Dale Eaglesham, colors by Alex Guimaraes, and letters by Dave Sharp. The title of the story is Good Talk. Basically, Kyle is out in space sitting in a construct of his old New York neighborhood, talking to Alex outside of Radu's coffee shop about the fact that he misses the old days. Things were simpler when he was a hometown hero, and now he's kind of lost his place in all the chaos of the different Lantern Corps, the emotional spectrum, and the United Planets. Basically, Kyle is on the same page as a lot of his fans. Nothing about the current state of things feels right to Kyle. He knows he should be doing something, but he isn't sure what. That's when Sojourner Moline shows up. Apparently, a lot of the veteran Lanterns don't like the direction things have been headed, and Jo thinks she's figured out what's actually going on with the United Planets. Which is music to Kyle's ears, because he's tired of sitting still and listening to rules that keep him away from home. I like that Jo is the one who may have figured out what the United Planets is up to. It makes sense that it'd be her, not only because she's good at detective work, but also because she served as Oa's representative on the United Planets Council during the entire last run of Green Lantern. She knows how they operate, and she may even still have some contacts within the organization, or even some level of access. Either way, she's the only Lantern we know of who's actually been a member of the United Planets Council, so she'd be in a position to have some unique insight that would help a lot right now. Kyle's trip down memory lane was nice, and bringing back creators who left their mark on that era of Green Lantern is always a welcome sight. Although it was kinda weird to see Ron Mars paired with Dale Eaglesham instead of Daryl Banks or Paul Pelletier, since Eaglesham's run as artist came after the Ron Mars run ended and Judd Winnick came on as writer. But I'm being too picky, these pages look great, and it was nice to see Dale Eaglesham draw Kyle again. Though I did not appreciate the way they tried to fudge the timeline by having someone in the flashback film the battle with a smartphone. Kyle hasn't lived on Earth full-time since 2 years before the first iPhone, and that's talking about the end of his solo series. This flashback took place years earlier than that. And look, I understand that the ages and timelines of these characters operates on a sliding scale, and maybe I'm just biased because of how this all overlapped with my childhood. But as far as I'm concerned, you cannot separate Kyle Rayner from the 1990s any more than you can separate Alan Scott from the 1940s. Okay, just one more thing before we get out of here. Kyle's coffee is real. It's the only thing besides him that isn't green in this whole fake New York. When he dispels the construct cup, it falls onto the construct table. When the construct table goes away, it falls onto the rocks. Where did he get that coffee? I don't think I'm ever going to get an answer to this incredibly important question, but thankfully right below the puddle of mystery coffee is text promising that next issue is going to have a Jessica Cruz backup story, and I can't wait. So that's Green Lantern number 8. I'd call it a massive improvement over number 7, but what do you think? What are the implications of these Lanterns who can cycle through the emotional spectrum at will? Is there any chance at all that Hal will get a clue and leave Carol alone? What do you think of these backup stories being used to catch up with characters like Kyle and Jessica, while also folding them into the larger storyline? Tell me all about it in the comment section down below, and remember to subscribe if you haven't already, because this story is really starting to pick up the pace, and things should only get more interesting from here. In the meantime, thank you for taking the time to watch. My name is Dan, we'll talk again soon.